after that, let me introduce a little bit more about myself, since most of you do not know who I am. Once again, I'm Jay, I'm Korean, and I've been working here at Rice for the past 4 years. And before that, I did my PhD in consumer psychology, studying how consumer motivations work and how they interact with their possessions. But it wasn't that my route, my journey to Rice, was good. When I was in my early 20s, just like many of you guys here, I absolutely had no idea that I'm going to study marketing. In fact, I did have a number of interests in various fields. I had a bank internship, I volunteered at an independent film festival, I even worked at a human rights department within a law school at the official where I did my undergrad. And by the end of my graduation, I decided that I should take LSAT and become a lawyer. So I studied really hard, got this textbook, and registered for several law school related courses. I studied really hard, just like how I used to do. But then on that day of the LSAT exam, there was this sudden moment where my brain froze. It was as if I'm having a brain fog, and my entire page went blank. At the end of that day, I was crying a lot, came back home, decided to cancel my grade because I didn't want that score to be on my legal document, and to this day, I do not know what I got. And for several months and so on, it was a desperate moment because I didn't know what I should do. I didn't know what I'm good at. I didn't know what I truly enjoyed doing, where I lose the track of time because I enjoyed something so much. But now, looking back, after 10 or 15 years, I'm so glad that that moment existed for me because that was the best moment in my life. Now I took a totally different career. I'm a researcher studying consumer psychology. Today, I'm going to talk about what motivates people to engage in an activity and how that relates to their performance in the long run. So I'm going to talk about sharing economy, and many of you heard about that concept. A lot of brands use this concept. Uber, WeOne, Lyft, of course, Airbnb. And there are other business units that allow you to share your possession, whether that be a toolbox or a letter, or even you can rent your parking space. So just to give you a sense of how big this industry is, let me compare it with one of the very well-known business unit, which is Hyatt. So Hyatt is a very traditional hospitality unit. It's a business that allows customers to pay a certain amount of fee and they rent a room. Whereas sharing economy, Airbnb is quite different because they merely serve as a platform and they connect individual consumers like you guys with the rest of hosts who are willing to open their properties. Let's take a look. Hyatt currently is valued at $9 million. It has 235K rooms in over 69 countries. By contrast, Airbnb is valued at $90 billion. It has 6 million rooms in over 220 countries. And it's literally everywhere. Let's take a look. So if you are interested in bringing your family and friends to Rice Campus, there are a number of properties that you can find. For example, I heard of typed in Rice University as a keyword. And this is literally where we are. There's a long list of properties that show up. If you're interested, you can click on a few properties. Like this is a place, a private room in Uptown, hosted by this lady. And this person is charging $73, which is slightly cheaper than a hotel price. And if you're interested, you can take a read on the description of the property and also take a look at a few amenities. Now, if this is what's interesting, you can take a look at a few more photos. It's a spacious living room. It seems like this host is biking. Kitchen is spotless clean. how long your vacation stay starts. Now let's think from the perspective of an Airbnb. For an Airbnb to succeed and to draw a lot of consumers like you guys, they need to have a good and nice properties. And in order for them to have good nice properties, they need to have a good number of hosts who are highly engaged, who actually have nice homes to provide. And this is an advertisement that they use to attract potential individuals as a new host. My home, house, fund my startup. It is emphasizing the opportunity to make money by opening up your space. But as a researcher, I was curious to find out whether this is the only reason why people open up their own private homes. Could there be other reasons that motivate people to share their homes? And depending on what motivates individuals, is it that their performance differs? So what I did in the past few years was to work in collaboration with Airbnb. And what I did was to post a simple question. Why don't you just start posting? So whenever host logged in, this text appeared in a pop-up screen, and host responded in a few sentences or just even a few words. And over the course of several months, I was able to get 24,000 responses from 101 countries. Now I have a long list of data that now I have to analyze. So I incorporated some of the state-of-art technology in text mining, like closed-off factorization and LDA, which I'm not going to talk about in today's speech. And what I found afterwards was quite intriguing. Well, first, yes, it's true that majority of people are driven by the desire to make some extra money. 60% of those. But the remaining 40% of these individuals were driven by non-monetary reasons. And those motivation was to meet people. They wanted to enjoy the convenience of their home and invite guests from around the world, learn about their culture, and interact and make a new connection. And there was also a group of people who just found a great joy sharing the beautiful aspects of their home, whether that be an interior design, or the backyard, or just the city, the location that they were proud of. Of course, some people may be driven by one motivation, just by one motivation, but some people are driven by more than one motivation. So what I was interested in was whether each of these motivations lead to different performance and different behavior. Before my analysis, I categorized these people as monetarily driven individuals who are extrinsically driven because they are using this activity of hosting as an instrument to achieve another goal, whether that be a supplement of income and so on. But there are other groups of people, non-monetarily driven individuals, that I call as intrinsically motivated individuals. They are enjoying the activity because the activity itself gives them pressure. And because they are all hosts, I examined how their advertising as business owners differed. And of course, they are individual hosts, so they can decide how to describe their home. And what I found was that those who are intrinsically motivated, those who wanted to meet people and share beauty, actually wrote many more words because they wanted to provide more details to their potential guests. They also posted more photos, hoping that this directs their potential guests and learn about their properties. And of course, first these hosts can decide to open this as few nights, as long as many days, as like 365 days per year to potential guests. And it was these two other groups of individuals who opened days. So they were highly engaged. They had this good motivation to bring people in. Another aspect that I was interested in was their tendency to be persistent. Like, just many of you guys are now probably wondering that whether you should really be a host. Many people may actually join out of curiosity. But after a few interactions with 5 guests or 10, some of you may realize that, oh my god, this is not my thing. Some guests are crazy. And you guys permanently quit. What we found here was that it was this latter-two group of people who are non-monetarily driven that actually stay much more engaged over a period of time. When I also examined the degree to which they really got the star rating from their guests after their stay, compared to people who did not have this motivation, having the motivation to meet others and share beauty actually led to a higher star rating. So, another important question that I have as a marketer is the following: who makes the most money? And to find an answer to that, I need to find out how much they charge per night. And although some of you may wonder that, well, non-monetarily driven individuals are not interested in cash, so they don't charge a lot, that was not the case. So compared to those who are monetarily driven, people's decision differed by motivation. First, I have to tell you that, well, a lot of properties differ in characteristics. Some hosts are providing the entire home, some just private homes. Some have a lot of amenities, some just little. Refrigerator exists or not, parking space, there's jacuzzi, there's doorman, it's a suburb, it's in a big city. You know, the zip code level of real estate price may all differ. Even the country. Even after accounting for all these different variables, there was a significant difference by the intrinsic drive, such that those who wanted to meet people charged a lot less. Which makes sense because having a lower price can draw more people in. They deserve the hope. But those who wanted to share the beautiful aspect of their home, you know, there are some people who are just very attached to their home, despite the objective quality of their home. They actually charge the highest. So what's the ending result? After incorporating all their available calendar data, as well as their pricing strategy and their star ratings, what I found was the following. When I projected their future profit for the next 3 years, it was this last group that made the most money. So what can I tell as a researcher? Remember this earlier poster here? I can tell Airbnb two things. First, hey, Airbnb. Yeah, you're targeting consumers, but you know what? You're only targeting one part of consumers and you're leaving the 40%. Remaining 40% that stay on tap can potentially be more profitable than customers in your end. You're just leaving those people out. So perhaps diversifying your strategy to recruit this potential host can be better for you because you as Airbnb is just getting a proportion of that service fee as a fee for Airbnb. Now, I want to pose this question. We are not Airbnb hosts, most of you guys. Now, what can we learn from this entire experience? Earlier, I mentioned that individuals are driven by different motivations. There are people who are extrinsically motivated, those who engage in a behavior because they want to achieve something else. And there's intrinsically motivated individuals who engage in an activity because the activity itself gives you so much pleasure. And this distinction of extrinsic and intrinsic motivation is called self-determination theory, which was first proposed by social psychologist theorist Ryan in the 1980s. And this context has been mostly investigated in the context of education. And these are some of the things that these researchers have found out. For example, in the context compared to athletes who are intrinsically driven athletes are more likely to overcome hurdles because they believe in themselves. In an elementary school setting, when students were evaluated and categorized into two groups by running some sample surveys, some students just worked really hard because they like to get compliments from their teachers and their parents, or they like to get the gift from their parents in return if they get a high mark. There are also a group of people who really enjoy the process of learning. And there was no performance difference up until the third year. After they went to the fourth and to junior high, it was the latter group of individuals who performed better because the learning required much more autonomy. With this insight, how can we apply that into our own selves? Many of you are affiliated with RICE, and that means that you guys pretty much outperformed in your junior high. And you're probably using this opportunity, your moments and your at RICE, to achieve your next goal, whether that be your MCAT score, your law school, or your dream job at a consulting firm, or at Apple or Amazon. Are you choosing your major or your classes just to use it as an instrument for your next goal? Are you choosing your classes because this class perhaps guarantees you an easier A than the others? Or are you really using your opportunity, your time here at RICE, to reflect on who you are, what you're really good at, what you feel passionate about, what you enjoy in acquiring the skills? In other words, are you more extrinsically driven or intrinsically driven? Now, I want to conclude with the quote from an American author, Joanna Jess. Intrinsic motivation comes from within you and is powered by your own dreams, aspirations, wants, and wishes. Thank you.